Polisi anakuja kwako, anaingia kwa nyumba ya watu, akipata TV, polisi anauliza wewe receipt ya TV. Anabeba wewe, unaenda, wanakupeleka kwa studio. Mostly wanafanya hii maneno on Fridays. On Fridays wanajua tu, Saturday utakuwa hapo, Sunday wakibagain na wewe, utatoa pesa ngapi. Na hivyo ndio kazi wanafanya hapa, kuangaisha raia, kienda huko, mara unataka 15,000.
There is a total collapse of systems within the police, which is why the police are able to get away with it.
You know, we don't want to cheat, and police never cheat.
This dusty road at the heart of Kinoo Town, and this spot specifically, is one with a special place in the history of the peaceful and quiet town. It is here where Victor Ouma and every Kioko lay dead. The locals would then be told of the killing of two very, very dangerous criminals. But were they?
Sunday morning of the 22nd day of November 2015, it greets the residents of this little known part of the country with shock and grief. Murder, it was.
Mimi nilikuwa kwangu tu asubuhi siku hiyo. Nilisikia mimi mwenyewe nilisikia risasi. Na sikujua labda polisi wanakutana ni wakora ama ni polisi.
The officer who was firing fired 3 rounds of ammunition.
Two men aged between young and those slightly approaching 30 had been killed by police officers undergoing their routine patrol in the area. According to the police officers, the young men were gangsters. Every Kioko was a border operator who lived here at the Oasis Court 2012 up until 5 a.m. November 22nd, 2015, the day and hour of his murder. Kioko, famously known as Kasei by those who knew him well, and Eriko for those who knew just another border man, was on the fateful morning set for work. The 22-year-old was set for Kangeni. 45 or say 50 meters from where the Rastaman lived, police officers not in uniform, KTS is told, would emerge from the nowhere. Meters behind Kioko was another man, 28-year-old Victor Ouma. Victor is said to have been shifting to a more affordable house. It had rained heavily the previous evening, the Saturday that Victor Ouma purposed to vacate to his new rental. Unfortunately again, a Manchester United game was going down that night, and the Manchester United fan would have rather missed everything else.
Hasa kufikia hapa mali imefika kifo yake, Victor alikuwa kihama.
Hiyo siku yenye unasikia Victor alikuwa ameuawa, on Saturday kabla uawe asubuhi ya Sunday, Victor hata alikuwa Kinoo hapa, alikuwa anaona mpira ya Manchester huko Kinoo. Hata mimi nilikuwa huko Kinoo kwa shopping center. Siku hiyo baadaye mvua ilinyesha kwelikweli around saa moja. Mvua ilinyesha almost mpaka karibu saa, ilinyesha kwelikweli mpaka karibu saa tatu hivi. Na siku hiyo ndio Victor alikuwa ahame. Sasa mvua ilimzuia.
Even the estate in which they were saying he was vacating from to another one, we ended up there and there was nobody who was telling us about that one.
Now, this was home to the late Victor Ouma Ogat until the fateful morning of the 22nd day of November 2015. Nothing apparently is left here apart from this rope which held his curtain, a curtain that is currently being held at the police station.
Okay.
Manekin.
Victor will then wake up very early Sunday morning and embark on a mission to shift to the new home.
Siku hiyo aliama na vitu chache. Akakuja nazo, akakuja na bibi yake. Baadaye kwa vile mvua ilikuwa inanyesha, akatoka kesho asubuhi aende vitu.
He collected some of his stuff and kept them parking at this food joint, about 3/4 of the total distance between his place and the destination. He will go back for the last of his items, a table, a stool, and a curtain. Unfortunately, that will also be the last of a man who is defined by those who survived him as a quiet, kind, friendly, and peaceful soul.
Wakati alifika tu karibu na mahali aliwacha hizo vitu zingine, hapo ndio alipata na askari polisi. Sasa ile kitu sikuelewa kama walijibiana na polisi ama ni nini, lakini tunapata habari waliongea na polisi. Ni kama polisi aliuliza yeye alikuwa ametoka wapi na hizo vitu ni nini, na akamwambia, akasema yeye si mwizi.
Lakini mara ya kwanza walikuwa wameongea.
Alikuwa tu anauliza huyo kijana amebeba nini. Akamwambia yeye si ni kuona anani.
Those who work in a nearby food joint very close, in fact at the scene of the murder, tell KTS they had a man say, "Msiniue, mimi si mwizi, ni kuhama na hama." What they will later hear were gunshots. 3 in all, 2 at first and 1 later, much later. The food joint staff accounts matched an account earlier given by this man who doubles as a charcoal seller and a guard at the Oasis Court 2012, Eric Kioko's resident, but that was before the 22nd day of November 2015. The guard was on duty the morning of the shooting and had earlier given an account of all that happened. It emerges that Kioko was on his motorbike as police officers killed Victor some 15 meters behind him. It was dark. They would then call the young man to where they were. The police shot and killed the 22-year-old Eric Kioko. His major and only offense, as can be determined, was that of witnessing murder. Could it be that the two police officers would have left after killing Victor Ouma, but not after realizing that the murder of the 28-year-old and father of one had been witnessed by Eric Kioko and it was time to clear evidence? Mark Odongo, uncle to the slain nephew Victor Ouma, says, in fact, he heard the gunshots that morning. Little was known to Mark that the sound of gunfire he had heard had claimed the lives of two people, among them his nephew.
Mimi nilikuwa kwangu tu asubuhi siku hiyo. Nilisikia mimi mwenyewe nilisikia risasi. Na sikujua labda polisi wanakutana na ni wakora ama ni polisi.
The tragic news of the shooting and killing of his nephew will be broken by a friend almost immediately.
Sasa baada ya muda kidogo niliona tu mtu amenikongea. Au mtu ni relative wetu mwingine anaitwa Edward. Edward akaniambia, "Ah Mark, nimepata habari mbaya." Nikauliza, "Ai, habari mbaya ni gani?" "The Victor amepigwa risasi na polisi. Sikujua kama amepigwa na amekufa wakati huo. "Ai," nikauliza, "hiyo habari umetoa wapi?" Kaniambia, "Ah, rafiki ya Victor mwingine ndiye amemwambia." Ndiye akakimbia akakuja kwangu. Kaambia, "Ah, wacha tuende." Kufika kwa njia ndiye aniambia hata ninasikia tayari ati wamechukua yeye wampeleka mochari. Ni mtu amekufa. "Hey," nikasema, "na Victor, umesikia alikuwa na inasemekana ati alipatikana na nini ama alikuwa anafanya nini? Ati polisi anasema ati ni kama alikuwa anaiba." Tukaenda, kufika hapo nikakuta umati kubwa sana ya watu. Sababu Victor ni mtu alikuwa amejulikana hapa sana. Amejulikana kabisa. Hata kushinda mimi mwenye nilimlete hapa. Nilipata umati kubwa kabisa. watu wanalalamika kabisa. Mimi wakati nilienda hapo, ni damu tu niliona. Hizo damu, moja ikiwa hapo hivi, moja ikiwa hapa nyuma hivi.
The police will then embark on a mission to justify the killing of every Kioko and Victor Ouma.
On the early morning hours of the 22nd November, that was at around 5 a.m. in the morning, our officers were coming back from night patrols. And when they were about to enter their camp, is when they heard an electric alarm from the neighboring estate.
On their part, the law enforcers talk of having responded to an electric alarm where they encountered six or more young people. Among these six or more people was Eric and Victor.
So they rushed there, and on nearing that place, there were a group of young people. They were about six, with two motorcycles.
The six people had two motorbikes which were to aid in the robbery. When asked by the officers to stop, they wouldn't. One of the six or more young people had not turned off his motorbike, and so he sped off. When another one of the young people tried to speed off, it prompted the police to shoot, in this case, Eric Kioko.
The second one, a difficulty in starting is a motorbike. So, and immediately when the officers were about to catch on him, he started speeding off. That is, it prompted the officers to shoot at him. And when they were shooting, when they confronted him, there was another person who was coming, running from inside one of the estates towards this motorcycle. So when he was about to board this one, he saw that the officers had started firing this one. He decided again to run forward. So the officers also followed him and shot him.
The other person OCPD Birgen Kipto is talking about is Victor Ouma. In his words, they followed him and shot him dead. If Victor was in one of the estates terrorizing its occupants, as the police account puts it, and Eric and five others or more were out here, it is not clear just how fast the five ran on foot, not prompting the police to follow and shoot them, let alone shooting them from a distance until later, when Victor emerges. Victor was shot twice, on his leg, while the other bullet went right through his chest. Did the 28-year-old try running after he was shot on the leg? Did he survive the shot on the chest and continued fleeing, prompting that he be shot on the leg? Or were the police determined to kill the father of one? Or still, was this yet another training ground for the two officers? Just where was Victor Ouma Ogat shot first?
No, I cannot tell now. Because he was shot at a distance, so we could not ascertain where he was shot at first. Mm-hmm. Yeah. From the reports, is that one of the victims was shot twice, and the other one was shot once. Yeah, and those are the three rounds of ammunition we were used.
If three shots were fired that morning, there seemed to have been no attempt to shoot at the other four or more young men whom the police say were together with Victor and Eric.
They were about, not exactly, because it was rush hours. There were a lot of movements because it was early in the morning. So the people who were met, it were in a group, and they were about, there were more than five, about six or more.
The police could not direct us to the home where an alarm rang that morning, resulting in the killing of the two young men. The police later in the day established that the alarm was as a result of an electric fault, turning the case into a coincidence that police officers respond to a faulty electric alarm only to meet very, very dangerous criminals. The police also claimed they had heard complaints that there was a black motorbike Boxer brand whose occupants were occasioning terror to the residents of Kangemi flyover through Rungiri.
No, there had been circulations that there was a black motorcycle Boxer which used to terrorize residents of that area, right from Kangemi flyover to Rungiri, using the, a black motorbike Boxer. So when the officer noticed that this is a black motorcycle, then we suspect it must be the one which had been terrorizing the residents right from Kangemi flyover to Rungiri, that is Kino area.
Apart from working on pure assumption, the law enforcers did not want to consider the registration number of this black Boxer motorbike at the scene of the murder that morning.
Kule hospidi ndio akatolea kitu kingine kama ina mnyama ingine nchuma tu mfano ya pistol haiko bunduki.
In another twisted tale of events, police will later claim that a homemade pistol was recovered from Eric Kioko's jacket.
And it is in our armory, that pistol, as an exhibit. Yeah.
Where was it found, baby?
In the jacket of the rider. It was found in the jacket of the rider, the person who was riding the motorbike.
The National Police Service Act requires that when the police shoot somebody, they prepare a substantive report which they present to their commander explaining the circumstances of the killing. The commander is supposed to share that report with one, the National Police Service Commission, which is the body that deals with internal police discipline, promotions and recruitment, and two, with IPOA, which can then follow up. This particular aspect isn't being done, so police shoot, provide their version of events, and that remains the story.
Bribery, among other breaches of the police conduct, seem to have a solid ground at Kino Police Station. The killing of Victor Ouma Ogat and Eric Kioko Mwasia might not be the last vice being committed by the protectors of life and property at Kino Police Station. For that is not all. We are trying to find our way to Wamu Mira in the internal interior of Kino. On either sides of this road are two mandazi kiosks. They are bound by an event retold to capture emotive happenings of the 18th day of October 2015, just a month before the murder of two young men.
Ilikuwa around saa 9. Tuko tumekuja kwa hii place yetu of work. Tuko tunapika mandazi hapa. What we were normal days on Sunday, watu tumekuja kupika mandazi. So, vile tulianza tu kupika mandazi at around 3, kuna the opposite base tuliona mtu mwingine alikuwa amevaa tu civilian clothes. So, vile alienda hiyo base, alikuwa zina ako drunk kidogo.
A man walked here and requested for a ride from a local motorbike owner who happened to be a mandazi seller. The man will be given a free ride, his destination Kino Police Station. He alighted from the bike, took the border border keys, asked the rider to park the motorbike in the police station and walked away. The bike owner did not know who this man was. He was a police officer. The owner of the motorbike, terrified following a series of border border men who have lost their bikes and others hacked to death without mentioning being robbed, he opted to report the case later. He dragged the motorbike back to his workplace. The officer will later come back to the mandazi joint in Wamumiro Kino. He cocked his gun severally. The gun was not loaded, and if it were, then the outcome of the policeman's early morning drama would be better imagined than experienced.
Tukaendelea tukupika mandazi, kupika mandazi. So after like 10 minutes, huo mtu akarudi. Kurudi hivi, tukasikia tu akisema police alikuwa ametokea the other side kwa jali pelekwa hivi ni kama kuna the other road ya huko chini nikaa alizunguka hivyo.
Bernard Omondi is nursing physical, emotional and psychological wounds from the occurrences of that day. Bernard takes us back to some 4 hours of pain and terror. Terror and pain occasioned by a protector of life and property.
Ngo si nilikuwa tunajua ana shida na sisi shida yake iko
sisi nani?
Sisi sai kwa hii base yenyewe walikuwa wapika mandazi sisi. Unajua the two bases kuna hiyo huko na yetu. Sasa vile alimalizana na huko akateremka sasa kwa hii base yetu. So kuingia akasema tu Tuani hizi vitu hapa.
Hizi vitu in this case.
In this case alikuwa anasema tu tuani hizi vitu hapa ni hizi mandazi nini hizo mafuta zilikuwa apikia hapo ni hizo ndio. So ai tukashindwa what's wrong. Alikuwa tu amelewa. Sasa so, unajua sisi tumeona tu amebeba gun na amelewa akisema tu tuani hizi vitu hapa. Sasa so, tunashindwa ni nini mbaya na sisi tuko kazi yetu sasa tumesumbua mtu tuko kwa kazi yetu. Kaka kidogo akakok gun. Kok gun ai tukakuwa terrified. Within a minute ameshapiga nini kara ya mafuta te, amepiga kara ya mafuta teke na ilikuwa inani face.
When Bernard and his co-victims of the early morning terror took to the police station, the same man they came to report emerged. It was at this point that the three for the first time knew that he was a police officer entitled to keep law and order. When he emerged, the officer interrupted attempts to have the victims record their case and have them issued with an OB number. They were later that day to be released on a cash bail of 1,000 Kenya shillings each, but again, didn't the police station have an official receipt book? This is the receipt issued after the payment of the release of Bernard Omondi, not Leonard, Dennis Kiboro, and John Waweru. Matthew Langat, KTS has established, is the name of the officer who took the Mandazi sellers of Wamomira through 1 hour of terror and attempted murder, an hour of living by faith. When our team sought to know the whereabouts of Matthew Langat, we are told that the man who served at the Kinoo police station had deserted his job and fled.
Immediately after that incident, the officer who did it deserted. And we are trying to locate him. Right now, we have obtained the warrant of arrest. And we are trying to locate where we can get him.
KTS investigative desk has since established that major police transfers, and indeed major ones, have since taken place at Kinoo police station. At least, Birgen Kipto could confirm.
We overhauled the whole post, trying to bring in better men who will be there to serve better than maybe those who are there who had been there for long.
Is it possible Constable Matthew Langat was part of these major changes? The Independent Policing Oversight Authority has taken Bernard's case. The IPOA contacted Bernard after the incident. However, by the time of running this story, there had not been response yet from the authority.
There are so many cases of police killing people. You know, what you're talking about is in Nairobi and the surrounding. But there are so many such cases and no action is being taken to ensure that innocent people are protected. Yeah, and IPOA, as it is constituted right now, does not have the capacity to deal with all these cases. So there has to be, we have either one to capacitate IPOA and give them sufficient resources to do the work. But what we have seen is that police, the politicians have begun to attack IPOA every time it begins to follow the police. They start making noise that IPOA is making it difficult for police to do their work. It's like the police want to be allowed to just shoot people and get away with it, which is not acceptable.
Back in Machakos, every Kioko Mwasia is dead. And with that, a family's future and a young life cut short, the best they can do is bury their 22-year-old son, brother, cousin, and friend. Victor Ouma Ogat has also been buried.
The police have since submitted the investigation report to the Office of the Director of Public Prosecutions. And if the Office of the Director of Public Prosecution works on the report submitted to it by the police, then justice to the families of Victor Ouma Ogat and 22-year-old Eric Kioko Mwasia might just as well be an alien word.
Sasa mimi ile kitu mimi naomba huyu polisi ashikwe na stakiwe kotini. Sababu yale maneno amefanya hiyo ni kama mauaji ya kiolela tu. Sababu uweze uwa mtu mwenye amesarenda. Mtu amesarenda unamuua.
Langu nitaka kuomba sana kama serikali ama mkubwa polisi pia chukua hatua sana, ashauri maskari wao ashike mtu, aulizwe maswali kwa nini unafanya hii tabia. Ambapo paka saizi sisi tunaogopa kuwa na ushirikiano na polisi hata kidogo. Jota kama utajua huyu ni muizi na kuwa vigumu kueleza polisi ulijua namna gani.
To up to date to just hear anything, it's like your case iliisha hivyo. So now we are just depending on IPOA.
You know, we don't want to cheat, and police never cheat.
Victor Ouma Ogat and Eric Kioko Mwasia joined the never-ending list of people felled by a bullet from the state. For KTS Investigates, it's Brian Obuya.
Landi pati zive ulole zande sako anfunu fana na banigasela.